Hi folks, I'm Matt and welcome to My Expanding Universe, a show where I go through the entire EU in chronological order as best I know how. Woo! You saw the title, you know what we're talking about. The original, first, six-issue run by Dark Horse, the Dark Empire story arc, which is arguably one of the best comic books that Dark Horse ever put out, one of their first ones too. Dark Empire is a story where Luke discovers that the Emperor is alive and well, if it's just in the form of a clone body. You see, when his body was thrown over into the abyss of the Death Star reactor in Return of the Jedi, a clone woke up at the same time laughing, is what we're told. Because this is, remember, the Emperor has always wanted to have immortality. And so he found that in a way. He's kind of cheated in a way by using clones. His dark side essence is entering these clones. So it's basically him just in a new body. The problem is these clones are not forever. And he's burning through them. His energy just burns through the clones. So he's not perfect and he's a little bit weaker, but it is the Emperor. And so what does Luke decide to do? Does he decide to fight him in the very first issue? No, he kneels before him and becomes his apprentice. And you're like, wait, what? Yes, Luke goes to the dark side. He takes over as the Emperor's right-hand man. The Emperor now has these world devastators because it's all about super weapons, right? And these world devastators just come onto the planet and just devastate, right? They live up to their name, so to speak. And the Republic's having a hard time figuring out how to defeat these things. Well, meanwhile, Luke is in charge of the new Empire and he's leading the way of killing off all these planets when suddenly we find out in the end that it was all a ruse and he did it to betray the Emperor, to get close to him, okay? And he gave the New Republic the codes to shut down the world devastators and everything. So this is a big epic storyline that you really got to read. Now, for those of you who saw Rise of Skywalker and you thought, ugh, I don't like that. I don't like the Emperor back there. Well, why don't you check out Dark Empire? I think it was done really well. Tom Veitch pitched this supposedly way back in the day. In fact, Marvel Comic Books actually has an ad for Dark Empire because they had it conceived way back then. But then Marvel lost the rights. When Dark Horse picked it up, Tom Veitch was the first one to say, hey, let's get Dark Empire up and running. So he went to George Lucas. Yes, George Lucas back then had his door open. You could talk to him. He said, look, I got this idea for Dark Empire. And his idea was someone gets into Vader's armor and pretends to be Darth Vader, you know, to lead. It's a charlatan, you know, just using Darth Vader's armor. Lucas hated that idea, and so he and Veitch together basically came up with the idea that it was the Emperor who was cloned. So everyone who talks about how terrible an idea, and I hear this all the time, how terrible Dark Empire is, well, you're talking bad about one of George Lucas's ideas, the man you idolize, because he was the one that helped suggest and approved that it was the Emperor who would be recloned. And if it makes sense, too, if you think about it, in episode 3, Palpatine is trying to convince Anakin, yeah, we're going to find immortality. He's always searching for ways to live forever because the Emperor wants to be in control forever. So that he does it through cloning, which we already know exists, makes perfect sense. And if you're reading this chronologically, you know the Emperor has cloning facilities all over the place. So this actually makes a ton of sense to me. Now, Lucas absolutely loved this comic book. He read it. He absolutely adored it. He thought it was great. They tried to get Timothy Zahn to, you know, combine it with his books. Timothy Zahn did not like the idea. He did not like working with comic books. He thought comic books were beneath him back in the day, and he did not want to appear to the comic book. So the comic book had to appear around the Thrawn trilogy, which they did. They just said it a year later. They were going to have it a timeline before Heir to the Empire, but when Timothy Zahn says, no, I'm not using that garbage, that comic book garbage, then Dark Horse moved their timeline. They did include some of it in the opening scrawl about what happened from the Heir to the Empire trilogy. However, that's the only crossover we get from everything. In fact, there are lots of, if you have the original comic books, you can read in the letter column where people are asking, hey, is this official canon with the books? And where Dark Horse had to respond with, we don't know. were unsure, you know, because they hadn't been told. And when Timothy Zahn rejected them, they thought, oh, I guess we're going to be separate, because they wanted to be a part of this party too. Now, later on, Kevin J. Anderson would wholeheartedly embrace them, right, into the canon, big time. And so it made the partnership with Dark Horse a lot more streamlined and brought the comic books into the continuity, something Timothy Zahn just refused to do. In fact, Timothy Zahn would belittle and mock this comic book, which I think is a big reason why so many people have a problem with it, because they love Timothy Zahn, and then they'd hear him badmouth this comic book, and then they said, yes, without even reading it. They're like, we hate that comic book too. You didn't even read it. You know, or if you did, you already had a slanted view because of what Timothy Zahn said. And I that's just how I feel, because he belittled other writers too back in the day, because he had his own little sandbox, his Thrawn trilogy, and he thought that's all that should matter, and the other stuff shouldn't connect to his stuff. And I, like I said, his views have changed now, but back in the day, it was like, no, he didn't want anyone else to be compared to his books. He's very proud of his New York Times bestsellers, as any author should be, but I thought it was just a little unfair to leave Dark Horse out in the cold. Now, Tom Veitch, for his credit, did a great job writing this. He had a great idea and utilized it and went forward with it. Dave Dorman did the cover art, which I can't tell you enough how beautiful that cover art is. Dave Dorman is a phenomenal person to talk to, and that cover art put him on the map. People started, and he told me, he said when he was doing the Heir to the Empire, Dark Horse said, we want a comic book that can catch people's eye as they're roaming their comic book show and go, ooh, what's that? Because you do, you look at the art. The cover art makes a big, big deal. That's why you have all this splash, cool cover art all the time. It's meant to attract the regular comic person. And so the comic customer walks in the store, sees issue number one, goes, ooh, that's interesting. I remember as a kid seeing these in my store, but then thinking, I don't think they connect to the book, so I'm not going to read them. And I chose to just leave them there on the shelf there. But I remember when these came out too. Now, this also introduces Boba Fett and is back. Beforehand, I mean, obviously, chronologically, we know he's back. But in publication order, we had no idea. We thought Boba Fett was dead. So the big revelation that Boba Fett was alive was really huge. I remember all my friends, because a lot of people back in the day when they read comic books, they did read Dark Empire, like, Matt, Boba Fett's alive. I said, how is he alive? He died in the Sarlacc pit. No, he made it out alive. You know, everyone was super excited. That thought was and it is a super cool moment in the comic book when you realize Han goes to his old apartment on Coruscant, and that's where he discovers that, you know, his old robot butler says, a Mr. Fett to see you, sir. And he's kind of repeating it, Mr. Fett to see you, Mr. Fett to see you. And Boba Fett's right there. It's really awesome because Boba Fett's back on track to get Han after all of these years. And that's really cool. Now, I think Fett is flying the Slave 2 at this point. It looks a lot different than the Slave 1. And that was a little odd, but I like it. They went a little bit differently there. And I should mention, I don't mention art much, but Cam Kennedy's artwork is phenomenal. Phenomenal. I remember a long time ago talking to an artist about Cam Kennedy and Dark Empire in general. I said, I just hate that guy's art. He went, do you hate the art or do you hate the color? The way it's colored. And I thought about it, I was like, well, I hate the shades of pink, green. It doesn't look that good. He said, yeah, but have you ever looked at the art? Take away the color from it and just look at the art. And then he said, and tell me, is there any artist that looks any way similar to Cam Kennedy? You know a Cam Kennedy comic book the moment you look at the first page, because his artwork is so unique, it's unlike anything I've ever seen, and no one has duplicated it. And when I took a second look at the comic book, I realized he was exactly right. Cam Kennedy's art is great. It is very unique, and to this day, I've never seen anyone come close to copying it. Now, we have copycats all the time. Nothing wrong with copycats. Craig Capullo draws a lot like Todd McFarlane. And there's a lot of other examples I could give you too. But you can kind of see, and like a Jim Lee book. You know it's Jim Lee the moment you open up the book. But there's how many comic book artists can you do that with just by looking at the first page? Not that many, I would imagine. Not that many. I mean, maybe a big comic book guy would be able to, but the average comic book collector would not. So Cam Kennedy, to me, did a fantastic job with that. And those aren't the only books he wrote. I mean, he drew. He drew a ton of other comics, too. But I'll get to those later in another video. See you then. Did I mention that Dark Empire was one of my favorite comic books ever? Yeah, we should go back and edit that in.